Hi, my name is Olajide Olabiju, and I welcome you to this lecture titled How to Resolve a Conflict, Lecture 67. This is part of a daily lecture series titled How to Resolve a Conflict. And I would like to begin by showing you the book that guides our discussion. It's titled How to Resolve a Conflict. Show you in a minute on the screen. Yes, How to Resolve a Conflict. So essentially what we do is read and then have a discussion. Welcome again. I hope you'll be able to subscribe to this channel as well as if you have comments, send them in. I would also be great if you could get a copy of the book, How to Resolve a Conflict. It's available on all Amazon outlets. So we are now discussing multi-track diplomacy. Lecture 66, we dwelt a lot on that. And the idea of all of us in the community, different sectors, not just those of us who are mediators, professional mediators, but others who are doing one. Working together, we all of us in the multi-track, government, professional mediators, educators, media, community leaders. Yeah. There are nine sectors in the multi-track, or nine tracks in the multi-track diplomacy. We are all working towards peace, whatever we are doing. Education promotes peace, media promotes peace. So we want to see ourselves from that perspective. Government promotes peace, and then work together, let's work together. And so that we could have greater mileage than we could get from our individual efforts. So that's lecture 67. I started that discussion, and I can also continue today. So that's it, we are using the book, How to Resolve a Conflict, to guide our discussion in this lecture series titled How to Resolve a Conflict. I'll read, and then we have a discussion. So I read, constituents of multi-track diplomacy. Constituents of multi-sector approach. Constituents of the multi-sector approach. So sometimes I say sector, sometimes I say track. It's the same thing. Now, the government in conflict resolution. Governments promote conflict resolution through diplomacy. Diplomacy can be a tool for enhancing trust, confidence, and understanding, and for negotiating, mediating, and intervening in crisis, to resolve conflict and to prevent war. This is the formal approach to conflict resolution. Professionals in conflict resolution. That's the second track of sector. After government, I read, this is conflict resolution involving non-governmental bodies and individuals. It encourages communication, understanding, and collaboration towards a joint resolution of their problem by the parties in conflict. This is informal conflict resolution. It gives the latitude to explore the root causes of and the underlying human needs in a conflict. It also makes it possible to have a confidential forum for resolving a conflict to avoid loss of face for either party, to identify obstacles to better relationships, and to create original solutions that go beyond the immediate conflict, thereby ensuring future harmony. The sector also promotes face-to-face communication, which ensures human touch and, per consequence, sensitivity to the views of others, breaks psychological barriers, focuses on building relationships, and reframing the conflict to look like a shared problem that can be resolved by collaboration. The third sector, business and conflict resolution. Business promotes conflict resolution by creating a strong pathway for communication and collaboration. Business alleviates economic needs, thereby removing a very important source of conflict. Business promotes human solidarity because through business, we actualize our common and global interdependence. Business also makes peace by influencing government decisions. Business cannot flourish without peace. Consequently, business has a moral and beneficial duty to fund conflict resolution. Next one, the private citizen as mediator. The focus here is the building of personal cross-cultural relationships between individuals of various communities to create the necessary grassroots forum to address issues of mutual concerns, to break down stereotypes, promote friendship, provide needed resources, and educate the public and policymakers on peace and development. Next one, the rationale for, this is not the next one, this is the further explanation on the sector that's talking about the private citizen as mediator, the track of private citizens. So the rationale for this personal approach to conflict resolution is the belief that one, each of us as individuals can make a difference. Two, the grassroots can provide leadership to their political leaders. Three, we are all peacemakers. Four, each of us can make a personal commitment to changing our community for the better. Five, power resides not just with decision makers, but also with the grassroots. Six, when we develop a personal relationship with others, we begin to see their humanity rather than view them as enemies. And finally, seven, peace is a function of the well-being of the individual. No food, physical or spiritual, no peace. Okay, so we now move to the next sector or track, the academia in conflict resolution. The focus here is on learning and passing on information to the community on how we can best live together in peace. The rationale is that the more we learn, the more we are able to generate ideas on how we can move our world forward in spite of the challenges that confront us. Also, study helps us discover alternative ways to conflict resolution. Finally, to change the world for the better, people must first and foremost be educated. Next track or sector, activism in conflict resolution. Activists seek to change institutions, attitudes, and policies through political action. It presupposes that without justice and integrity, there can be no peace. Activists believe that citizens have the moral duty to oppose unjust policies and laws and to secure the well-being and rights of the oppressed. Emphasis is placed on grassroots participation and leadership. Activism is a mass movement. Its primary focus is not to generate understanding, but to bring to light and agitate against actions and policies that are immoral, oppressive, and anti-justice. This is in line with the agenda of the mediator. The mediator cannot be a tool of injustice. The office of the mediator necessarily creates a level playing field. In the absence of a mediator, some conflicts cannot be resolved. That is, those conflicts where there is power disparity. Next sector track, religion and conflict resolution. Religious communities bring morality and faith in God to play in conflict resolution. They are motivated by their faith to serve the people of God. They assume the oneness of humanity. Love and compassion are the bonds of humanity and the vehicle for lasting peace. Peace is our right as children of God, and we must exercise this right as individuals in order to have lasting peace. Next sector of track, funding. Funding as a tool of conflict resolution. Every mediator needs money to operate. The money comes from people who fund conflict resolution. Fund providers play a role in conflict resolution by setting guidelines for their sponsorship of various initiatives. The wealthy have a right and a moral duty to judiciously use their wealth to make our world better. Finally, the media and communication conflict resolution. The media promotes conflict resolution through its programs on peace. It provides an opportunity for people to be informed and to make good choices. It is a forum for public discourse and public relevance. Their activity also shapes public opinion while also giving the public an opportunity to be heard. Modern communication allows for a wide access to information by and from the largest number of people, and by consequence, gives an opportunity for people to make an informed and human impact on the process of conflict resolution. Okay, so those are the nine sectors of Ambassador McDonald and the Diamond Multi-Track Diplomacy. An incredibly wonderful addition to the promotion of conflict resolution and peace building. As I explained earlier, when we pull these various sectors, when we put them together, make them work together, we effectively leverage our ability to effectively resolve conflict. And the first way, we make all these sectors, every individual in these sectors and these sectors, corporate, individual, corporate bodies, we make them realize and see that their action, even though it's not direct conflict resolution, it is indeed indirectly conflict resolution, because what they are doing impact peace, promotes peace. And I've given examples before. The government plays a big role in conflict resolution. I've given examples of specific governments setting up mediation centers, conflict resolution centers, training mediators. Can work with several people, so I know exactly that government is playing a big role here. And then the others that you mentioned, let me go back and mention them, look at them one by one. Professionals in conflict resolution, that's non-governmental police and individuals like myself, mediators. We are not government, but our role impacts peace, because we provide the skills, as I'm doing this daily lecture series, to improve our conflict resolution efforts, to make conflict resolution more effective, more impactful, to make positive changes happen, to recreate relationship, to build relationship, to solidify relationship, not just between individuals, but between cooperation between governments and citizens, between governments among themselves. Great role that we are playing in professionals in conflict resolution. Business, by creating jobs, you are building peace effectively. Of course, by making sure that those workers, they have access to the best practice in conflict resolution, some of which we are privileged to share here. You are also promoting peace, because you can set up policy, as I've mentioned in an earlier lecture, a set of policy guiding your own organization, saying, well, here we support effective amicable conflict resolution and provide mediators to make that happen. So that when there's a conflict internally in the organization and even with external providers, your customers, clients, the policy could be relied on to resolve those conflicts and make it. And private citizens as mediator. But yeah, private citizen does not mean that you cannot promote peace. You can effectively be a driver of conflict resolution, especially those individual private citizens who are respected for one reason or the other, their achievements, whatever, that they become respected. Imagine you now becoming a mediator. So you could give your weight as a respected community member, as a respected citizen, national, you know, international citizen, to make conflict resolution more effective, more impactful, to make it happen more, to promote peace, to build peace. You know, and you recognize that's several reasons why you as an individual can promote conflict resolution, peace building, you know, can improve the peace of the community. You know, I started those several. The fact that you can make a difference, the fact that you as an individual can provide leadership to the government, the fact that you as an individual can be a peacemaker, a mediator, the fact that you as an individual can make personal commitment to make things change for better, the fact that you as an individual have the power not just with decision makers in government or elsewhere, but also with grassroots, you can make things happen from the ground up. I certainly believe that things are built, and I think it's common sense that you build from the ground up. I mean, the failure of a number of systems are probably podcast organization and situation is because they want to build things from the top down. You don't build from the top down, you build from the ground up. The fact that when we develop a personal relationship with others, we should do as individuals, we begin to see their harmony rather than view them as enemies. When you get to know people, when you get to close to them, you are able to empathize with them, humanize them. And I also said that peace is a function of the well-being of the individual. Yes. So the individual is very important in peacemaking, peace building, conflict resolution, in making changes happen. Then we also spoke about the academia, mission the academia, educators. Yeah, I'm an educator. I also wear a cap of educator. One of myself, I'm both a mediator and an academic, you know, and I'm teaching. One of the things I do as an academic is to teach conflict resolution. But even if I wasn't teaching conflict, just by being an academic, by being a teacher, by being a professor, I impact people for peace. Because when I promote, when I deliver education, I improve the culture of people. And people who are more cultural, I believe, are more sensitive. And therefore, will not only prevent conflict, but they will have more finesse, more skill to manage conflicts when it happens. We also talk about activists in conflict resolution. Activists want things to happen. They are very important. They want changes to happen. If the work of activists succeed, the work of mediators is better, because some of the things that will be mediated over and over again would have been dealt with by your activists. So they are not activists, are not enemies of peace. And I mean, activists promote peace because they promote justice. And as I read earlier, they one of the greatest promoters of justice, the mediator. I read that the mediator cannot be a tool of injustice. The office of the mediator necessarily creates a level playing field. They also talk about religion. Faith people, they are big in conflict resolution, peace building. They are great mediators. You know, their beliefs in love and compassion, and the birth of humanity. Those are vectors for poverty and peace. Funding, those who fund conservation, several good foundations promoting peace. They're also indirectly being in a mediation. I mean, it's because they provide the money that we mediators and peace builders use to do our work. If we're not funded, how do we do our work? So funding agencies are very, very important. Foundations are very important. Foundations that promote conflict resolution by providing the money needed to make it happen. The media also huge. I mean, my idea, which I'm sharing with the world through How to Resolve a Conflict lecture series, my daily lecture series, how will it happen without the media? And so, of course, the media also provides us feedback. You know, I'm able to know what people think about what I'm teaching, promoting, supporting, doing, because the media provides me the channel to make that happen. I think we'll stop there for today, and then tomorrow we'll continue. Still on that much track diplomacy, we'll be talking about the agenda of the much track mediator. Please remember to subscribe to this channel, press the red subscribe button. And then, remember to, if you have any, post your comments. And remember to see if you get a copy of this book, How to Resolve a Conflict, which is textbook for this lecture, and which helps you to follow the lecture and more and better. Very importantly, and probably most importantly for me, apply the skills you are learning in your life. For example, we just talked about multi-track sector, multi-track diplomacy, how various people that interact with different from where you are. Let's say you are a teacher, you are interacting with the media, you are interacting with government. Network those people you know in those different sectors in your community, begin to build them into a network that promotes peace, that promotes effective conflict resolution. You know, by their being, when they're doing better, by their being supported by you, you know, make them realize that they are very critical, important to conflict resolution, to peace building and peacemaking. You know, when you begin to work together, collaborate together, your community begins to speak peace, you know, and therefore become a peaceful community, because when you speak to one another, you speak peace. And of course, that is when you're speaking to outsiders, other communities. You speak because you have a culture of peace, you speak peace to them and begin to teach other communities. Yeah, peace, by the way you speak to them. As a matter of fact, you can then also duplicate what you are doing in that other community, in those other communities. So that's the way you are applying what you've learned in this lecture to your life. And of course, life can only become better. The community can only become better. Our world can only become better. And don't forget, you can't have peace anywhere except it is built everywhere. You cannot have peace anywhere except it is built everywhere. Thank you very much. And I'll see you tomorrow at lecture 68. Oh, we just had this lecture 67.